I am Vibeke Sørensen, and I'm originally born in Denmark, and my parents came to the US when I was 3, and then we went back when I was 16 for 4 years. I studied architecture in Denmark, and went back to the States, and went back and forth, and eventually went to Singapore for 12 years, and I just got back from Singapore last May, and of all places, I'm in this amazing Northern California location in Palo Alto at Stanford University. And I'm at the Center for Advanced Study in Behavioral Science. And it's very inspiring here because I have access not only to the brilliant people here and the university, but also the animal life, which is outside the window over there. I've been making visual music since the 70s, actually, because when I studied architecture, the first day of school, my professor said, architecture is frozen music. I said, that's it, liquid architecture, that's what I'm going to do. Well, I had been a violinist and a pianist and played guitar and grew up with parents who were both in the arts and the sciences. So breathing, painting, and abstraction in particular was very much a part of my upbringing. Because I played music, because I was a musician, it was a natural extension of that. The more recent work is this idea of what I call calendar music. We exist in space-time, and in a way, everything we do in life, the way we conceive period of our lives, the rhythms of our lives, the way we organize them, that's expressed also in how we officially structure a time like a calendar. Professor Steve Lansing, who is an anthropologist and ecologist who works on Bali, showed me the Balinese calendar, very beautiful. And I said, to me, this looks like something like a piece I made called Concurrence, because I worked with pattern and geometry and form and then diagonals and verticals, and it's beautiful, but it also has deep meaning. To me, it's also a score, because I think of the abstract image also as a musical score. And it can be playing in real time, or it can be like a map. If I assign notes to each day and shapes to each day, I can speed it up a bit like time-lapse. I used to do space animation for NASA, and it can animate. But why the Balinese calendar? Well, the Balinese calendar has 10 concurrent weeks.
Here's the one-day week with a single day colored gray. Next comes the two-day week. Here's day 3 of the 3-day week. And here are all 10 concurrent weeks with their colors. On each successive day, the correct note from all 10 weeks will play.
So you have these repeating patterns, polyrhythms, of people's activities, but underlying that is this abstraction, you know, how they conceive space and time, how they structure their life in space and time. Two of the weeks are offset. They don't all start on day one. And there's no calendrical reason for it. So what I did was I was trying to find out if that could be, there could be a musical reason for it. And so I did that. I assigned shapes and notes for each day, and then ran it. And I did this with pure data and ran it live. And best guess what? It actually is musical. So this kind of gets at why I'm interested in abstraction, because I see this as permeating actually the way we think about anything in time and space. It's a coding of how we structure our lives and our understanding of our cosmos. I'm also working on something called dream networks. The people dream, perhaps also in an abstract way. I mean, we know there are visual images, but I mean, representational, but ultimately we learn to interpret something representational. Actually, all representation is an abstraction. We use metaphor, you know, to connect those things, but that's another thing. So I'm trying to also work on structures that arise between people because of the connections between dreams, dream networks. Memory, the way people encode memory, is also very abstract. So, for instance, the development of writing, for instance, is the abstraction, you know, for counting, for marking time also. You know, like the marks on the Venus Lascelles is also a mark, a hash mark. But that represents a sense of time connected, of course, to the body, but the body as a part of the cycle. I mean, it's basically a scientific phenomenon that they're discovering. And then, but it's also a mystery. I mean, maybe science, but science is still phenomenological and mysterious, and underlying all of that are also very, you know, deep abstractions. So I studied science, I studied mathematics, I actually had a degree in mathematics. And I find that really useful. I think of these things as fundamentally expressing or translating, I should say, the deep structure of the universe around us into a form that we can apprehend experientially and conceptually. Singapore, where you have people from primarily South Asia, but it's also an international city and country, and people come with many different religions, and religious harmony in particular is a tradition in Singapore. My research assistant, Nagaraju Tamanapalli, is from India, and when I was working on this one, which is called Mayur, he even named it Mayur, meaning peacock. It was drawing, it was making mandalas, and it was coming alive. I mean, because I was working with the line and time, almost like a thread, but also like a wave. I mean, everything has more than one meaning in my work, even though it's abstract. He would be teaching me about what it means in Indian philosophy. And so that really helped me understand a cross-cultural meaning that I didn't know before. So I feel like this cross-cultural content actually comes from the people who I meet from those countries, because I can read about it, but to really understand what it means in terms of symbolism and connection to their cosmology, I need to hear from the people. So I'm a happy student. Mayur was mostly drawn, After Effects. I actually drew the lines and then animated them, and so it was largely drawn. And whereas this one, Vishwaru, is algorithmic. Of course, I set up all the conditions. I created all the shapes. It didn't generate itself. It's just that I set up a live process with a composition in 3D and in 2D in it, and defined some movements, and then set up a polyrhythm with beating waveforms. Music is, you know, as I said before, we have the rhythms and the waveforms and the elements of music that I could translate into imagery, and then it would actually moved the shapes, and then I gave it a little bit of independence, shall we say, when I set up a process that has so many elements that when they combine, there's something new all the time. I made 300 versions of this movie, and they're all different. And I picked one I like the best. It's generative in that sense. It's not only the machine. The machine changes it, and it does it in a way that's surprising because it includes something that's a phenomenon that I generated and didn't even know. It's called a state transition in physics. And apparently this is not just when you boil water and it goes from liquid to vapor. That's a state transition. You live with a state transition all the time, you know, when things change state. Well, it turns out when you have these shapes and colors combining in a certain way with some recursion, but always slightly differently. At a certain point, when you have a specific speed and a specific set of conditions that align, all of a sudden the thing explodes. I had no idea that was going to happen. And it's really exciting. So for me, this was a discovery that these phenomena, it's also abstract. It exists in different domains. It exists in the physical world, but also in the computational world. I was really surprised. Naga, my assistant, was sitting with me, said, "Oh, if you show this, you know, in the temple and the ashram, people will pray to it." I said, "Oh my gosh, I'm thrilled to hear that, but I, it's not for me to say." "Why is that though?" He said, "Because you're creating new worlds all the time. It's this endless process." Vishwa means universe, and Rup means form. So it's the creation of worlds, you know, through the form. It's from Hindu philosophy and means the appearance of God or Brahma in forms that incorporate the creation of worlds and the universe within them. He named that piece because he said, this is what it is. It's exactly what it is. And how is that, that out of this animation approach that we can do such a thing? The creative process, it's different, you know, because I play musical instruments, but I think also I draw. I mean, I would draw a lot. I'm thinking about deep structure usually, you know, as I said before. I'm fascinated by phenomena. Geometry is part of nature. I see this as all, these abstractions are actually part of nature. I don't see it divorced from the real world at all. The underlying, you know, structure is mathematical, and that connects art and you know, the physical world, and even, and of course the abstract world, because it's in. And so I actually usually look at, I try to see the connections and things. I try to understand. I'm always trying to understand some phenomenon. And sometimes I draw it. Sometimes I try to see it proportions, you know, like composition. It's just how I look at the world. You know, I try to understand this great mystery and how it works with, you know, what we might call the skeleton. And then what the beauty of many of these abstractions is that they're, you can see that actually visually and musically that it actually is associative, if you will. You know, it suggests so many things, but it's not those things. Fascinated by natural phenomena, for example, like aurora borealis. Crystal aurora, one of my pieces, from 2012. That was from being in an airplane and looking down at the earth and seeing this, and I thought, wow. And I don't know if people, if I'm the only one who has this, but after I've been out, for example, in a beautiful landscape all day, or I've been on a plane and I look down at the earth, at night it all plays back. Some people tell me it doesn't happen to them, but it happens to me, and I want to capture that. And that's another thing where I think, well, how am I going to do that? It's like a vision, you know, and then how am I going to, and that's, again, I need to have some approach to doing it. But it doesn't need to tell a story at all, because it's an experience. It has no beginning, middle, and end. It doesn't have a dramatic structure, per se. You know, it doesn't have to have a moral, or it just, there's an epiphany. I've experienced something new and beautiful, and you want to capture that and find a way to translate that into something other people can also experience. You have the visual art on the one side and music, and then you have the science. When I was in school, you had to pick one or the other. And that was really a problem. So I thought architecture actually brings everything together. So that's why I studied architecture. But it was, you know, I really wanted buildings to move. So I thought, well, yeah, but we're moving through the buildings. That's a kind of, I mean, if you're shooting a film, you know, it's a subjective experience. So I got interested in film because I thought that was a way to get at it, because it was in the early 70s. I played jazz violin at the time. And I was an architecture student, and I went to Morocco and there was, I don't know if you're familiar with Ted Jones, who's a jazz trumpetist. He was in the group. A lot of American expatriates were there at the time, and I met some of them. But the interesting thing is he would play in the middle of a medina, and all these people would come out with their drums and start playing. And I thought, oh, imagine if we could do that with space and shape. You know, but not only in a square somewhere, but connect the whole world. So I thought, oh yeah, Global Visual Music Project. That was 1972, February. I had that idea. So I thought, well, okay, most likely we'll need computers, because you need to be able to define exactly how a physical space looks. I already realized it's going to probably be computers. But to have people communicate, probably we'll need some kind of telecommunications. And then we need to have the rest of the visual arts, you know, painting and sculpture, but somehow that has to also be involved with that. But the other big problem was the visuals need to flow in real time, the way a musician performs a musical instrument, and you need to be able to interact and react, call and response, like a musician, like in music. And so, oh my gosh, how are we going to do all this? So, but I had that idea then, and by the way, years later, I got a grant from Intel in 1997 called the Global Visual Music Project. Now, what happened in between? I said I have to go one step at a time. And so what's available now? Well, it was video synthesis, audio synthesis, right? But it was photography, film, drawing, photography, film, video, then early computer graphics, then interactive media, right? Well, 3D, 2D, 3D, interactive, then network. You know, and then, of course, the immersive along the way. I started doing 3D in the 70s. It was clear it needed to be immersive, but then it also needs to be scaled up. You know, we could do projection. I was doing multi-monitor installations and trying to integrate that into the architecture. And then I started making architectural installations and putting embedded systems into actual objects, because as I said, actually abstraction is in the environment all the time. We just don't think about it that way. sometimes it doesn't quite work. People don't see it the way I intend it, so then I go back to the abstraction. Then I'm deciding, okay, well, we want to go back to the physical world, so I've been making wearable technologies, including devices with abstraction, paintings that interact, and I've been looking at big data. My mood of the planet is a big arch, and it changes colors and speed and movement and sound based on an analysis of Twitter feeds looking for keywords that are about the mood of people around the world, how they're feeling. And then it picks, well, it doesn't pick, it just maps that to colors. Now, color mood associations are not universal. However, depending on the part of the country and world I'm looking at, or the country, I will pick a mapping and use that. And that's in connection with people who work in neuroscience. So it's not just me doing the association. And that gets displayed with moving colors and sounds that I've also created. And I thought nobody would get it or like it. And actually people just go, that's the impressive thing. They want to be surrounded by the light because it's beautiful colors, it's, you know, but it's also the sound. And it, again, the meaning, what is it? Actually, it's not a narrative, it's a state of being. So for me, that's visual music. It's just using big data and real-time processing. And then the other one I just finished a year ago, or I'm still actually doing the music, is called Starlight. It's, you know, using the quasar data. It's quantum entanglement and relativity. And I worked with a physicist, and Steve Lansing, who was also a complexity scientist, on this too. They were talking about where we are in quantum entanglement, that when you start measuring the light changes when you start observing it, right? That it's a phenomena that nobody totally understands. At the same time, we're actually measuring two distant quasars, one from 12 billion years ago, another from 8 billion years ago. And so these are streams of numbers that are actually coming in. I use 1.5 million of these. They were talking about it. I said, hey, wait a minute, that's just 100. It's 1,500,000 readings. Can I see what that looks like? So this is the math coming. It's four digits. You know, it's like 1.5 million, but four at a time. And I said, hey, wait a minute. That's two quasars, and then sometimes it's entangled when it's being observed, and sometimes it's not. And what entanglement means is they both become exactly the same, even though they started out random. So I used the same arch, that, you know, the thing for the mood of the planet, and put one quasar on one side, represent, you know, the translation of that data, and one for the other side, and one is redshifted, so it's more red than the other one, because the light, it takes longer to get there. And then what I did was, it's a simulation. I put a camera on it, so when a person is looking at the arch, both sides become, it's not just that they become the same, the entangled data is, the real entangled data from the real measurements are displayed. The simulation is just that you're not actually, it's not reading live, right? But it's the real data. Now, how could you see what's on the other side of a two-sided arch with light going out? Well, I put a mirror on either side. So you, as you look through the arch, a huge arch, you see the reflection of the other side in the mirror. And then that reflects the other side from over here. And then when they become entangled, then you see that it gets repeated like an infinite line. When it's not entangled, it's just random, and it's other colors. What about the animation? Well, for me, my influence is Mondrian with the squares, you know, except it's light. It's pure, it's very abstract, it's very simple, and it's not elaborate, but the quality of the light is so beautiful. It's because the light is going through crushed glass, which refracts and diffracts the light and you see all these amazing colors. And then the sound. What about the sound? Does it need to have sound? Well, yeah. Actually, it works quite fine without it. So, and the first version has no sound. I started working on the sound. It's new that I'm just starting to work on it, and just taking the data sonification. And it's quite beautiful because you could hear that. It's as though you have a dialogue between these two distant quasars. And, you know, of course I have to pick pitch and all of that. But it's incredible how emotionally we accept that, you know, or to connect that emotion, because again, there's this epiphany of understanding. No, experience, because I still don't understand it, but I do experience it. And to bring that kind of awe out through some kind of creative process. I usually had the idea first, you know, although sometimes by exploring the potentials of the technology, I discover things, sure. Because for me, the technological side of it is fascinating and it's easy to get caught up in that. But I don't want that to drive my work. I'm more interested in the ideas, you know, the concept, what it is. And maybe I don't succeed always because you always have to deal with the technology. I start with the idea, then I try to find the technology that allows me to possibly realize it. But the thing I love about the flexible technologies, our technologies that we invent ourselves, is that there's something to discover. It can take you to a place that you hadn't expected. And that's really exciting. And that's one thing I like about this technology. The other aspect of it's a bit political. I like the idea that the artist can redirect technology to something humanistic. I like the idea that we're redirecting the technology. So I got involved with technology development quite a bit. So I ended up doing a lot myself, even if it was clunky and not so elegant. But so that's how I got involved with technology development. I like that. I think that's the artistic spirit. You know, we're always trying to make leaps and then is there some other way? You know, can we do it? And if we have to invent it, okay, we'll do that. But it's slow. It took 25 years to get to the point where we could do network visual music performance. I still think the beauty of nature is somehow transcendent. It's all part of nature, although I think it should support nature more. The illuminations piece, because that's site-specific, that was set up several times in different ways. And I'm the person in the background. I'm always behind the scenes reprogramming because I see this and see that. I mean, that's the thing with the real time. I'm always changing it. But there comes a time when you think, no, that didn't make it any better. Then I realize it's time to stop, or at least for the day. But most of my pieces, I don't actually feel like they're finished to the degree that I had wished for. So one is I'm making it worse. Another is I run out of time. It is what it is. Another thing is I just get interested in something else, and I'm on to something else, and it's a moment. It exists as it is. So there's no one right way. But the idea that you can refine something to the point of perfection, the thing is exactly the way you wanted it, the way you envisioned it, you hoped for, that's also occasionally possible. Particular piece was complicated. I'm working with Indian music, not so much Balinese music. And the Balinese cosmology, now I know a lot more about, and that's part of it, is that I feel like it doesn't quite capture it. And because I know a little more, I know more now. And the timings are such that I either have to go to one or another way. I either have to make it more synchronized or a lot less synchronized. I have visual music math. 1 + 1 = 1, or 1 + 1 = 3. 1 + 1 does not equal 2. Visual music. Because you can synchronize, so that they reinforce each other so much that you can't, they become, you know, they're just absolutely fused into one thing. You know, the timing and everything is exactly the same. Then there is the 1 + 1 = 3, the two together, the two separate things come together and make a third thing in their relationships. And that's usually what I try for. Or at least part of it, you know, it's like counterpoint, you know, or in music, we have multiple voices, and each one can go up away and come back, and the other one can go away and come back and they go forward. So musical metaphor for how music and image interact is very important to me. They need to work, you know, in a complementary mode, but not always. It could even be totally separate, but together it creates a reflection on the other, you know. It's a more intellectual process. Kind of like what Cage and Cunningham were doing. Set up rules, it would be, you know, 4 minutes, and they go off to their separate things, and then the piece is putting them together and finding the happy accidents, which you can't always predict. You know, that's what's the contingency and the chance. Chance in art is very important to me also, some of that. And then there's the different senses, the visual music of the senses, you know, which is another thing. How does, you know, how do other aspects of your life affect how you're perceiving it? That's another subject. I never do the music first. I always do the imagery first. And then, because it has to work visually for me. And then I see it as a musical score of some kind. Synesthesia I have a little bit of, not as much as, you know, people talk about, but I do have some. It can suggest sounds in my head when I look at imagery. So I usually work silent, partly because the image has to have its own integrity. I feel it's a respect for the image somehow. And then later, I will make music, and sometimes it's not even related to it. And I discover that actually I had been must have been carrying it in my head, or something like that, that process. But also, you see, because I played piano and violin, you know, and did electronic music in the 70s, and I used to alternate 2 years making music, 2 years making images, 2 years making images. So that's how it used to be. I don't want the technology in the way of experiencing light, you know, and visual music and abstraction. So that's why I started working with actual light. I think there's a long way to go because the technologies are effective. I mean, I do wearables now, right? And I'm using fabrics and putting embedded systems and things like that. That's still clunky. I used to think what we really want is flat, flexible, scalable, bright as daylight displays. But even that is a clunky display, something that we can actually work with in a plastic way, like sculpture, or going, what, paint? Even the beauty of our original art forms, you know? I mean, actually, they're kind of fine the way they are. But to understand something more about the science behind it, and then allowing us, in a very respectful way, to access those phenomena, for example. So there's all kinds of things still to invent that could make the clunkiness factor go away. And it's still an incredible phenomenon to be alive on the planet today in nature. And if we can potentialize that in some as yet to be discovered way that gives us this kind of, these kinds of experiences, that would be better. When I was at USC, I was at a professor at University of Southern California, School of Cinema, Television, now Cinematic Arts. I was there from 1994 to 2004-5. And that's an incredible school. By the way, before that, I was at CalArts for 10 years, also incredible. And but at USC, they're known for narrative. And I said, but I don't do narrative work. I do non-narrative work. I do this abstraction. Well, by the time I left, I thought, well, narrative is the meaning we give to sequential sensory experience, which means that it is possible for people not to seek associative meaning, you know, to just simply experience, you know, the deep structure, as I like to put it. But even that understanding of that's what's going on, you could say, is an interpretation that is a kind of narrative. It's slightly different. But that's what I mean by meaning, that it's not random. And I can give you another example. Years and years and years ago, before you were born, I was giving a talk at a university in Virginia in the architecture school showing abstract work. And a professor came up to me and said, your work is just random images. And I said, yeah, well, that's what people said to very famous composers when they started making music they didn't understand. That's just random notes. I'm sorry, you just don't understand it. It's highly structured, actually. I mean, that's one of the problems, you know, with the abstraction. Although, as I say, I think people experience it in daily life. It's, you know, the way people perceive the world around them, I believe, does get abstracted. We see fragments of things and put them together. And just like when somebody's going to sleep or waking up, it, you know, decomposes from something representational to something totally, so to speak, formless, although I don't believe it's formless, and converse. I think people experience it all the time. They're just not maybe aware that it's that they're living with this abstraction all the time. So one of the many beautiful things that Punto Raya does is show you the variation. And not only that, how many people are now making abstract work now and submitting to the festival, right? It's thousands and thousands of people. So I think people are discovering that partly through seeing the work that inspires them, but also maybe reflecting more on their own experience, that this has become, I actually think everybody knows it. I think just my appreciation for all the people who are still working in abstraction and, you know, the pioneers who passed away and how I hope that, you know, all of their beautiful work will continue to be seen, and the new generations of people will come into the field and, you know, enjoy it as much as we do and contribute their incredible visions long into the future.